is Kaustubh Kakde from PIMS Maharashtra, India. I am a final year student and I am discussing surgery with you all, a systemic as well as general approach. So we, in the last video, started with breast surgery, under which I discussed about the anatomy of breast surgery, right? So now continuing with the breast surgery anatomy, last time we did about how the breast looks anatomically, what are the components, what would happen if there is disturbances. So now we are going to discuss about the blood supply, including the arterial and venous blood supply, as well as the lymphatic drainage and what is its importance surgically, right? So the first thing I am going to start today is the arterial supply. I'm going to start with the arterial supply. So this image that you can see in front of you, this supply shows you arterial supply, shows arterial supply of breast. Okay, so now you can see this is the thoracoacromial artery. From where the thoracoacromial artery is coming, this is actually coming from the axillary artery. This is coming from the axillary artery, and from axillary artery you are having thoracoacromial artery. The branches of thoracoacromial artery, they are giving the major supply. They are giving approximately 30 to 50% of the blood supply to the breast. Okay. Whereas there are certain other arteries as well, like lateral thoracic artery. Lateral thoracic artery, this is coming from thoracoacromial in few cases from the subclavian artery. This is a variable artery. So lateral thoracic artery in many different parts from the body, different arches, from arches of aorta, from subclavian, in different individuals, different origin of this artery has been noted. But we can see that the lateral branches, these lateral branches of the lateral thoracic artery are supplying of this lateral thoracic artery coming from majority of the times from thoracoacromial artery is actually supplying 20% of the breast, Then you have the internal thoracic artery. The internal thoracic artery, which is coming from the subclavian artery, it gives about 10% of the blood supply to the breast. Apart from this, you also have blood supply from posterior intercostal artery. Okay, now if you check the venous drainage is very, very simple. Venous drainage is directly from into the axillary vein or from few of the branches going to the superior vena cava. But one clinically important thing you need to know about the venous drainage. One more important thing about the venous drainage you need to clinically know is that two important things. One important thing is the lymph nodes that drain are related to veins. So when you actually operate, when there is a case of malignancy, a breast cancer, you need to remove the lymph nodes as well. You need to do an axillary clearance. Yes? So during an axillary clearance or axillary lymph node dissection, you need to locate those lymph nodes in relation to the veins. Okay, we will see that in some time. Now, if you check, the other importance is that the veins, they communicate with the vertebral venous plexus. Now, how does it communicate with the vertebral venous plexus? That we need to know. Okay, the intercostal veins and the branches from superior vena cava. So suppose this is the breast. We are looking at and schematic diagram. Okay, at a schematic diagram, this is axillary tail of spins. This is axillary tail of spins, nipple areola complex. Now, please have a look. Please have a look. The veins are going to drain from breast into the vertebral venous plexus. So suppose these are the vertebrae. These are the vertebrae behind, posteriorly. What they do is, there is going to be a vertebral venous plexus. There is going to be a vertebral venous plexus. And this communication takes place with the very important plexus in between. This important plexus in between, which is called as Batson's plexus. Okay. This is a very important landmark because through this Batson's plexus, there is metastasis to vertebrae. So if there is a lump, say, suppose there is a lump over here, this lump the malignant cells will metastasize to the vertebrae, mostly to the lumbar vertebrae, and there you will get osteolytic lesions. That means there will be bone destruction. So if there is deposition of malignant cells over there and destruction of bone takes place, your patient may present to you with bone pain, a backache, mainly in upper lumbar region, or pathological fractures, right? So now let's have a look at the venous drainage. Now, if you see the venous drainage, you have already seen that it is through superior vena cava and axillary vein. So from superior vena cava, axillary vein, and the intercostal veins, it is draining into the superior vena cava only. And the intercostal veins are also communicating with the vertebrae, because of which it has a very, very important surgical importance that there can be a malignant cell from the malignant lump of the breast going to the vertebrae. Got it? Now we need to understand the lymphatic drainage. Now see, the lymphatic drainage is 70% from the axillary lymph nodes and 20% from internal mammary group of lymph nodes. That is between the two mammary glands, that is between the two breasts. We don't have much importance of internal mammary here now. Clinically, yes, we have. We will discuss it when we go to lymph node and their importance in some of the upcoming videos, right? So now talking about the axillary video. Axillary lymph nodes. Now, axillary lymph nodes basically are divided into different groups. So, anterior, posterior, lateral, central, interpectoral. Interpectoral means they are present between the pectoralis major muscle and pectoralis minor muscle. This group is having a new fancy name, which is called as the Rotter's group of lymph nodes. And then finally, from all of these, this is finally draining into the apical group of lymph nodes. From the apical, it may also drain to supraclavicular lymph nodes. And that's a very important clinical importance, that when you are palpating for the lymph nodes, never forget to check the supraclavicular also. Not only in a lean individual, but it is also important to palpate for the lymph nodes in the supraclavicular fossa. in obese patients especially. Why obese patients? Because we know axilla has large amount of fat. So in an obese patient, definitely more amount of fat will be present over there. So there is possibility that even a small swelling of lymph node may get hidden within that fat. That's why what you should need to check is you may have a direct supraclavicular node which is palpable without axillary lymph node being palpable, right? So that is the importance. Now, as I said earlier, every lymph node is lymph node group is related to specific vein. Interpectoral is related to the muscles. What is the relation? The anterior group is along the lateral thoracic vein. It is along the lateral thoracic vein. Okay, the posterior group is along the subclavian vein. Lateral group is along the axillary vein. And your apical group is also along the axillary vein. So this is how surgically you identify the lymph nodes when you do a dissection. When you have given an incision in the axilla, you open the axilla. You clear the axilla by cauterizing the blood vessels over there if there is any injury while cutting. And you start cauterizing the fat. You start burning the fat using the electrocautery. After the clearing the fat, you will get to see the blood vessels. You will get to see the blood vessels in which you will be able to identify the veins. And after you identify the veins, sitting on those veins specifically, you will get a specific lymph node. But if there are very abundant amount of lymph nodes, will it be easy for you to identify them? No. So that's why surgically what we do is we have divided each of these lymph nodes into different groups. Okay. So now let's look at this image and try to identify different type of levels that we have divided. So various, depending upon what staging of the flow of lymphatics is, that is from breast to a specific group of lymph nodes, from those specific next group of lymph nodes, that is what we called as the Berg levels. That is what is known as the Berg level, the Berg's level of lymph nodes, Berg's levels of lymph nodes. So if you check level 1, basically these Berg's level of lymph nodes are in relation to, these are in relation to pectoralis minor muscle. They are in relation to pectoralis minor muscle. So if you check level 1, this level 1 is nothing but anterior, posterior, and lateral group of lymph nodes. Here you can see level 1 is your green color. This is level 1. This is level 1. Now, level 2 is going to be central and the Rotter's group. Okay, it is going to be the central and Rotter's group. So this is your level 2. This is your level 2. Whereas level 3 is going to be above and medial. Yes, level 1 is below and lateral to pectoralis minor. Level 2 is related to pectoralis minor, directly above the pectoralis minor. And level 3 is medial and above the pectoralis minor. That will be your level 3. This will be your level 3. So level 3 is going to be the apical group. This is going to be the apical group of lymph nodes. So that is actually what is the levels of lymph node do we mean. Now in the upcoming videos, we will definitely sometime we will discuss about what are levels of dissection in breast surgeries. So that is what is, at that time we will discuss about various levels. Yes, that is the importance of understanding these Berg levels of lymph nodes. Level 1, level 2 and level 3. So that's all for this video. If you like it, do like the video, share, subscribe our YouTube channel, Inspiring Minds Coaching, and also follow us on Instagram. And also comment below this video if you want me to make any specific topic. Thank you.